Okay. Welcome to PinkAid's fourth lecture series, Navigating a World with COVID. We are very excited to have Dr. Bridget Killily and Dr. Zane Saul joining us today to discuss this topic. One of our key questions is how the pandemic affected breast cancer patients, including delays in releasing new drugs and beginning new trials. We will also discuss the vaccine and are we back on track medically? My name is Lori Sokol, and I am honored to be co-chairing this event with Asante Robinson. PinkAid holds a very special place in my heart because the work is all about helping individuals who are affected or touched by breast cancer. We try to assist those in need through our grant program, Pink Purse Initiative, and Deb Katz and Michelle Korneman, our co-presidents, for the discussion with Dr. Saul. Personally, I have been involved with PinkAid since I walked in the Warrior Fashion Show and then co-chaired the 2016 October event. I'm currently on the board and have co-chaired the lecture series since its inception. I am also a 12-year breast cancer warrior. Personally, I have been involved with, the first segment of our conversation will be with Asante and Dr. Bridget Killily. Asante is an incredible woman and I am in awe of her. She is also this year's event co-chair. Asante participated in the 2018 Warrior Fashion Show and is a 5-year triple negative breast cancer warrior. In Asante's work life, she is an independent Mary Kay beauty consultant with formal training from Central Connecticut State University as a journalist. Asante If you have any questions as you listen to the discussion, please go to the chat area and type your question. At the end of the second segment with Dr. Sell and myself, we will have a Q&A.
Welcome, Dr. Killily. Dr. Killily is a Connecticut native. She grew up in West Hartford. After college, she served as a Peace Corps volunteer in Paraguay, where she became interested in medicine and public health. After receiving her MPH from Johns Hopkins University, she attended UConn School of Medicine, followed by a general surgery residency in New York City at St. Vincent's Hospital and research fellowship at Columbia. She completed her breast surgery fellowship in New York City at Roosevelt Beth Israel and spent the next decade at Yale. While there, she helped develop and lead a comprehensive multidisciplinary breast program. She spent a significant amount of time in Europe studying oncoplastic breast reconstruction in Paris, France, Edinburgh, Scotland. She believes in personalized multidisciplinary care and works with her colleagues to find the best plan for every individual. Currently, she is the director of breast surgery for Hartford Healthcare Cancer Institute at St. Vincent's Medical Center, Bridgeport, Connecticut. When she's not working, she enjoys spending time with her husband, Chad, and her 3 children. Welcome again. So we're going to just dive right into this.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
We're so excited to have you here. So breast cancer did not stop when COVID started. So can you describe for us the landscape of surgical oncology now and specifically during the pandemic?
It was a very unsettling time. You know, as a group of doctors and multidisciplinary specialists, we really had to come together and figure out how we were going to best manage patients and weigh the risks of breast cancer and delaying treatment or changing treatment mid-course in some instances, with the risks of COVID. And it's hard to imagine now, but at the time, you know, when the pandemic started, there was a lot that we didn't know. We didn't know how it was spread. There was a lot of concern about PPE and having enough masks in the hospital. I remember that the OR was basically shut down completely, and we were just doing very emergency surgery for COVID patients, really. It was very difficult for me personally. I remember having to call many patients and tell them that their breast surgery was canceled. Wow. And that was devastating to me, but also to them. We gave a lot of patients medical treatment first, so either chemotherapy or sometimes endocrine therapy, depending upon what type of cancer they had. Mm-hmm. But it was very stressful.
Wow. So is that a little bit different than neoadjuvant, having it prior, like when people have, you know, chemotherapy first and then surgery?
It's really not different. Okay. That's a very insightful question. That's mm-hmm. basically what we did. People that we knew were going to get chemo after surgery, we started giving it before. Mm-hmm. And people that we knew were going to get endocrine therapy, we gave them endocrine therapy first, which is interesting. You mentioned they spend some time with Europe. They do that a lot more often in Europe. And I think one of the good things that has come out of that experience from COVID with respect to breast cancer is that we in the United States now, I think, have a little bit more comfort giving what we call neoadjuvant endocrine therapy. Again, for select patients, you know, depending upon what type of breast cancer they have.
Mm-hmm. That's so interesting. So have you seen an increase in cases, you know, because of all of the things that you talked about?
So at a local level, we're still encouraging everybody to come back for screening. We are still seeing some reluctance.
Really? Okay.
Yes. And, you know, I really want to just to all of our viewers and our listeners, I want to make sure that everybody understands that it really is safe to come back right now for your screening mammogram. And I know that, you know, for some people, there may be some fear or some reluctance, either related to COVID or I think also fear of the unknown. You know, mm-hmm. sometimes when things slip by us, it's a little hard to face it and make that appointment and get back in because you might be afraid that there could be something there. But it is still really important to come back and to get back on your screening schedule.
It's hard.
It's very hard.
Under normal circumstances, it's difficult to take that step. So now what protocols have you put in place to help, you know, people who are reluctant to come
in? So all of our facilities are cleaned in between patients. You know, our waiting areas are, we have social distancing in place. Everybody's temperature is taken, all of the usual COVID protocols that we've become so familiar with.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think we are starting to see things open up now too, you know, with the vaccine. I think I am so hopeful that we're really starting to turn a corner.
In the last week, we've heard about, you know, one specific corner that was turned in terms of the new cancer drug that's out. And can you pronounce the
drug? Yes, absolutely. So this drug is called Olaparib, mm-hmm. is the generic name. And it's a drug that's known as a PARP inhibitor. And this targets cancers that have defects in homologous recombination repair. So it's going after, you know, at the sort of DNA level. But this study that came out earlier this week in the New England Journal was very specific. It was looking at giving this drug in what we call a double-blind fashion, which means both the people who were administering the drug as well as those who were receiving the drug didn't know whether or not they were getting it or a placebo. That's what double-blind means. Mm-hmm. And it was for women who had already had chemotherapy, either neoadjuvant before surgery or in what we call the adjuvant setting after surgery, and were at very high risk. So this included a lot of women with BRCA mutations, many women had triple negative breast cancer, and those who had ER positive breast cancer had multiple lymph nodes that were involved. And what the author saw, this was called the Olympia trial, was that those who got the olaparib did have longer disease-free and overall survival. So this is very exciting and very encouraging, especially in this high-risk group.
That is so incredible. And, you know, just cutting-edge technology like that, you know, as a survivor, we're always so excited.
It absolutely is, yes.
So do you feel that things are getting back to normal, if you will, at the hospital? You did mention that, you know, all of the COVID protocols are in place. Are you continuing that? Are you continuing, for instance, telehealth and things like that?
So I think we are absolutely following all the guidelines. So in the hospital, everybody is still wearing masks, but many of us, like I've been vaccinated since December, we're very carefully, you know, easing the restrictions just a little bit. You know, for patients that are fully vaccinated that don't have any symptoms, we don't require COVID testing, whereas before everybody had to get a COVID test. So that
before surgery.
Yes, which would cause a delay, you know, with doing a lot of testing. And things I think are slowly getting back. I don't know if they're quite at what we would call normal, but yeah. I'm not sure.
I think we're gonna have a new normal,
right?
Yeah, the fact that we're sitting here, you know, with no mask compared to, you know, almost a year and a half ago.
Exactly, it is a big deal, right?
It's a huge deal.
And it feels good.
It feels incredible, it really, really does. So, you know, there's also been a lot of discussion in the news about lymph node swelling after getting the vaccine, you know, and someone who has like lymphedema and things like that. Is this temporary or is this something that they will have to live with?
So this is a very important point. So when you get the vaccine, the job of the lymph nodes is really to fight infection and to filter fluid. So when you get the vaccine, you're body's natural response is to alert the immune system, and that can cause some swelling or some enlargement of the lymph nodes. It's not dangerous, it's temporary, it goes away. The reason this has become an issue when we talk about screening for breast cancer is that lymph node involvement can also be a sign of breast cancer that's gone into the lymph nodes. So we are encouraging women who are getting the vaccine or planning to get the vaccine, if they're due for a mammogram, please try to have your mammogram first so that we don't have this confusion. If that is not possible and you have your breast imaging, your mammogram or your ultrasound after the vaccine and there is some swelling of the lymph nodes, we definitely want to make sure that we follow up with another test to make sure that lymph node enlargement or swelling has gone down. If it hasn't, then that's something that we would want to investigate further. We don't want to just assume that any lymph node swelling is due to the vaccine.
Right. Do you tell patients, your patients specifically, what do you tell them about the vaccine? Is this a warning to them? You know, you might experience, you know, with the normal side effects that everyone else has, do you specifically tell breast cancer patients about potential, you know, lymph node swelling?
Usually patients have already heard about it, but I do mention it. And I also just want to take the opportunity to reinforce how important it is to get the vaccine. This is another area where there has been some concern and some reluctance among some women about the safety of the vaccine, but it is absolutely safe. I got it in December when we didn't have as much data, and I feel so much better ever since I got it. Yes. Even our patients that are getting chemotherapy, we always encourage anyone who's getting chemotherapy to always work with your doctor. But as a general rule, we do encourage those patients to also get the vaccine. It's that important. Mm-hmm.
So continue to get your regular mammograms, continue to get your screening,
right,
and also make sure that you go out and get the vaccine.
Absolutely. So it's so That's exactly right.
Mm-hmm. So important. So we thank you. It was such a pleasure to have you here with us today at Pink Gate. So if you have any questions, this is absolutely the time for you to put them in the chat. We have Dr. Killily here to answer these questions. So please do that. We encourage you to do that for our discussion portion of tonight. So we thank you again for
coming. Thank you for having me.
And so now we're going to go to our co-presidents, Michelle Korenman and Deb Katz. Thank you all.
Hi, I'm Michelle Korenman with my co-president, Deb Katz. We are co-presidents of PinkAid and are delighted to be part of this program. Thank you all for joining us today. And a huge thank you to Dr. Saul and Dr. Kalia for participating in our fourth Warrior Connection lecture. Thank you also to the incredible Asante and Lori for putting together this informative program today.
We're so excited to share with all of you that within the next few months, we're going to be launching our peer-to-peer mentorship program. We've had over 400 survivors walk in our Warrior Celebration of Life fashion show, and survivors understand the importance of and value of sharing our experiences with someone newly diagnosed with breast cancer. Having walked in their shoes and understanding what they are about to embark on, we can provide friendship, encouragement, and inspiration. It always helps to see someone on the other side of the diagnosis. We will match a newly diagnosed patient with one of our warriors to help pave the way and provide a source of comfort, camaraderie, and friendship.
As the world gets back and our warrior connection with social activities, whether through card games, a book club, or just to get together and talk, it will be another opportunity for warriors to build empowering relationships. PinkAid will continue to create a community that provides friendship and support that one can rely on. Thank you. And now Dr. Saul and Lori.
Okay, welcome back to the main program. I think I got cut off, so I wanted to make sure that if you have any questions as you've listened to both discussions, please go to the chat area and type your question. At the end of the second segment with Dr. Saul and myself, we will have a Q&A with both doctors. Dr. Saul, thank you once again
for
today's event. Dr. Saul also spoke at last year's virtual event that was in the middle of the pandemic. You were amazing and comforting.
Thank you.
So Dr. Zane Saul is an internist and infectious disease specialist at Yale New Haven Health Bridgeport Hospital. Dr. Saul worked on the COVID-19 front lines. He is also an assistant clinical professor at Yale School of Medicine. Dr. Saul has been in practice in Fairfield County for 30 years. He has extensive experience in treating cancer patients who develop infectious disease complications during their cancer treatment. Dr. Saul has numerous publications in scientific literatures and is a frequent medical expert on television news. So my first question, when we were first beginning to plan today's event, the original title was Life After COVID. It was a few months ago. There was some concern that this may never happen. So we changed the title to Navigating a World with COVID. My question is, should we have kept the original title, Life After COVID? Do you think COVID will disappear even though there are some individuals who choose not to have a vaccine? And how does this affect the overall population of people who have had the vaccine?
Right. So there's a lot of variables that will go into that answer. First and foremost, yes, the vaccines. We want as many people to get it as possible around the world. We are already vaccinating now the teens, and we are starting the studies on kids under 12 years old. Hopefully that will be ready, and we'll start vaccinating kids possibly even before the school year. The more people that get the vaccine, the more protection. The big question, of course, is what about the variants? The vaccines that we have now do have really good protection against the variants. Now we're talking about the new variant, the Delta variant, that's come from India and England. The vaccines that have been tested do have activity about the variants. It's summer, we're gonna be outdoors a lot, But what's going to happen in the fall when we go back inside? So we don't know yet what life is going to be like after COVID. Another point about the vaccine is this technology, this mRNA technology that is part of the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. It's revolutionary. It's been around for a long time. It just never had a use before. And the funding that came from the federal government allowed them to develop this. What's revolutionary about this is that we're going to be able to use this for a variety of different disease states, possibly an HIV vaccine, possibly cancer vaccines, Lyme disease, and possibly a pan-coronavirus vaccine, which would cover all types of coronaviruses. So the question could be, maybe we could never see this again, but it's too soon to tell.
Wow. So what, just reiterate, how, like, would it be a year? Is this, like,
yeah, we're not going to know until we get back indoors in the fall. Okay. Last summer was okay. As far as the numbers of cases, we kept them low. We kept them into the low double digits, but still people were getting COVID. We mostly all stayed home, but we did things outside and, you know, wore our masks. Now that we're vaccinated, we can do more. We could go some more places, but until we move back in the fall and school starts and people are not doing as many outdoor activities and doing more indoor activities, then we'll be able to trace the numbers and see if there is a surge or hopefully not.
All right. So another question is, there are people who are vaccinated and they're still getting COVID.
Right.
Now, I know they don't get quite as badly, but so could you comment on that?
Yes. Let me give you the statistics. So right now, 130 million people in the U.S. have been vaccinated. There have been 1.9 billion COVID vaccines given in the world. Okay. So remember that 1.9 billion vaccines. There have been 10,000 cases of breakthrough of COVID in the U.S. Okay. 130 million people fully vaccinated, 10,000 cases. That's a fraction of cases. And many of these people had no symptoms. So of those 10,000, 1,000 were hospitalized. 300 of those were hospitalized for non-COVID reasons. They fell, they had surgery, they got tested, they were found to have COVID. About 160 of those people did pass away from COVID. So it's 160 people of 130 million people, very small fraction of people. The average age of the people that did pass away were in their mid to upper 80s. Okay, so we are seeing a very small fraction of people, usually much elderly people that have comorbidities, other underlying diseases that still got COVID after being fully vaccinated. So it's a very minuscule number.
Okay. So if I get sick, which happened to me a few days ago, and it's like somebody said to me, make sure you get tested for COVID.
Right.
It was a common cold.
Sure.
What are some of the symptoms and you know, why, you know, when would we jump to go get a test?
Right. So fever is the big one. Respiratory symptoms are the big one. Loss of taste and smell is a very common one. There are GI symptoms that go with it. So nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. But look, we're all just, you know, we're just easing our way out of isolation. So we're just getting comfort. So I don't blame you for thinking you might need a COVID test. A family member of mine had the sniffles and ran out and got a COVID test. It's understandable. And it's going to take us a little time till we stop that reflex. But, you know, the numbers are very reassuring that if you've been fully vaccinated, you should not get symptomatic COVID.
Okay. Well, that is good to know.
Yes.
Now, in a way, are we guinea pigs? Because we're getting this vaccine, and obviously we don't have studies for 5 years.
Right.
So when will, like, in a year from now, you said that when things open up, now California, I believe, is opening up on June 15th. I was watching late TV last night, and some of the shows are still showing, you know, tricks with the pandemic, and they were today. They weren't, like, you know, a repeat. So has TV caught up, and why are we still hearing so much when some of us feel like, oh, this is almost done?
Yeah, we're not almost done. There are places where there are people that are, the majority of people are vaccinated. Connecticut's great. New York is great. California's great. But they released data from Mississippi where only 20 to 30% of people have been vaccinated. And their numbers are not great. And they can still see surges. And just like the beginning with travel opening up, we have that possibility. So we're not done. We still have to do our work and we still have to be careful. But in Connecticut, we're doing a great job. And I think we all should be really proud of ourselves on how resilient we've been. You know, this is a 16, 17 month pandemic that we've all lived through and we were great. I mean, we stayed home, we isolated. When we were able to go out, we wore masks, we socially distanced. So we were anxious to get out and start moving, but let's go slowly and let's ease our way back into life that we knew before.
So my other question is masks, to wear or not to wear.
Right.
And let me just, the food industry, should the restaurants still be, you know, using masks? The health industry, to walk into an office. Somebody
right.
might have a cold who's behind the desk. And obviously travel.
Okay. Let me just finish answering your last question, which
I'm sorry.
I didn't. So are we guinea pigs? No, we're not guinea pigs. Now, you know, that number that I say it again, 1.9 billion vaccines have been given. Those are staggering numbers. If there was a signal out there of some adverse effect from the vaccine, we would see it. There has never been a death attributable to the COVID vaccine, zero, okay? So there has not been any. So we will continue to collect data. There's something called the VAERS, V-A-E-R-S, Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System, that once you get your vaccine, you can text that and they will contact you. I did it, and that's how we collect data for the longer term. They included women of childbearing years. They studied 30,000 women of either pregnant or in childbearing years, about to have a kid, getting pregnant or having a child. And we saw no signals, even in women of childbearing years, even in pregnant women. So we feel really safe about that. And we feel safe about saying women of childbearing years, it is safe to get your vaccine. Okay, now masks.
Thank you. That was
okay.
Very important,
okay.
By the way.
Yes. Okay. Now masks. Yeah, listen, if you're fully vaccinated, yes, we can start to go out, indoor dining, going back to gyms. I'm noticing that restaurants, the servers are still wearing masks. I think that's appropriate. I think it's positive. The question is, do we know who's not vaccinated amongst that group? So I have to say that in healthcare, we wear masks. Healthcare is not involved in the CDC's mandate where you can remove masks even if vaccinated. So every patient that comes to the healthcare, that includes doctor's offices, treatment centers, hospitals, must wear masks. You know, they're encouraged to wash their hands. We socially distance. We close chairs in the waiting room. We stagger patients so that there's not people waiting around. We wash down every exam table and every room between patients. So healthcare is not included in that mask removal mandate, okay? And I urge people, do what you're comfortable with, you know? And if you need to start with a small group of people that you know are vaccinated, start that way. But if you're a cancer patient and you're on chemotherapy, you know, I would say you probably shouldn't do that. Even if you're vaccinated, you should probably still do outdoor activities and make sure you do them with other people that you know that you're vaccinated, because you don't want to take the chance of being exposed to someone who may be carrying the virus that's not vaccinated and can potentially pass it on.
Okay. What have we learned from this pandemic? And where I'm going with this is, are there new efficiencies in hospitals? Because I was a chemo patient at Sloan Kettering and it was packed years ago. What did they do? Because you still had the number of patients, but you couldn't obviously wait in waiting rooms. You couldn't have a person with you. And So did we learn from that? And instead of, like, you know how you get things get better and you forget and then you go back to your old ways, is there things we learn to progress how patients are seen? What do you think about telehealth? All that kind of stuff.
All great questions, Lori. So, yes, first thing we learned is trust the science, okay? Science will guide us through. Let me just take this chance to say, science, history has taught us that vaccines are the way to end pandemics. We did it with smallpox. We did it with polio. We have historical perspective to say, this is how we end pandemics, okay? We're not there yet. We're not at the end. But science and history have told us vaccines are the way to go. And that's why we waited patiently for science. And they came out with this kick them out of the park vaccines. And it's great that we have it. But what we did learn about hospitals, interestingly enough, we did not have one flu case this year at my hospital. Okay. We saw almost no rhinovirus, which causes colds. No respiratory syncytial virus, which RSV, which we see in little kids. Why is that? We were wearing masks, okay? We were socially distant. And I think we're gonna probably be adopting these type of things in healthcare for time to come. I think telehealth is great as a way to screen patients. You know, not everybody knows what to tell the person that's making the appointment. But if you have a telehealth visit with a provider, you can ask some key questions to determine if they do need to come in for an office visit or if what they need can be handled over the computer. So I think we've learned a lot of key things. I think we're gonna see a lot of policy change based on this. I would not be sorry if I had to wear a mask in the hospital ongoing in the future, particularly during cold and flu season. I was happy not to get a cold this year. I was thrilled. So I think we're going to see some changes along those lines.
All right. So one of the other things I happened to love when I had to have a procedure was waiting in my car. They called me.
Yes.
I went in, had the procedure, went out. It was unbelievable. Do you think we'll continue some of that?
Something like that. You may have to wait in another remote area. We're not going to open up to full capacity waiting rooms again for a long time. We're going to stagger people more. We're not going to let people bring friends and relatives unless they need physical help getting in and out of the office as a way to try to keep, you know, there's some people would come with five people to the waiting room and everybody sit down. So we're going to try to do those. Keeping people in the car, we all liked it too. Yeah, it was great.
Yeah,
but I think we've learned that, and that's how we keep people healthy. I think we're trying to increase the numbers a little bit, but still staggering. You come into a waiting room, you're going to see chairs blocked off and say, due to COVID precautions, you know, these chairs are closed. So in my waiting room now, we have two chairs open. That's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. Now that's good to know. Can you comment on traveling internationally? I mean, a lot of people, you hear that the airports are going to be wild this summer. So domestically, but also internationally. I know a few weddings in Greece.
Right.
How smart is this? What should we do if we do go? Again, masks, I'm going to bring that up. I think we should all travel with masks always. So a little bit of that.
Yeah, travel also. I'd love to wear my mask all the time now on a plane forever. I may just do that. I think the airlines really want to come back in a bad way for a business perspective, but also people are just eager to get out. But they're really going through all the guidelines. Many, before they let you get on a plane, want to see a vaccination record. And so that's going to be one level. Mask mandate. And you've seen these people. If you don't wear a mask, the people around you start yelling and saying, put on your mask, put on your mask. So we've seen these fights happening on planes because everybody, you know, they want to be there. They want to travel. They want to see their parents, their elderly parents. They want to go abroad. So we're going to see people take precautions. I think it depends on the country. And I think the countries are going to have entry requirements. Hopefully it's going to go well. The U.S. is going to also have requirements. They're going to ask people to be tested either on the way to the country, some countries will ask that, or on the way back to the country, some people will ask that. Again, the vaccine plays a big, big role in making sure that we keep that transmission rate low with travel. But international travel is here. I've been on a plane. The first time I did it, I was nervous and scared. The second and third time, I felt more comfortable. I kept my mask on except to take a little sip of liquid and to have a bite to eat. But otherwise, I felt really safe, and everybody on the plane was masked, and everybody was being careful and respectful.
Okay, so the planes, hotels, I had to travel back from California during COVID, went to so much trouble to space people, to clean, washing hands, so many things that, you know, I think people just became rote. Are we going to go backwards? Do you think they'll keep some of this? Are the planes going to be packed this summer? So it's back to some of that.
Yeah, the planes, I mean, they're going to be crowded. People want to travel. It's human nature to want to get away after we've all been, you know, locked in our homes for all these months. I love the fact that when I got on a plane to go to Florida, they handed me a hand gel and a packet of hand gel and a packet of wipes to wipe down my area. You know, engage the travelers to do it as well. I think that's here to stay. I don't think we can be careful enough going forward, even if it's just to protect from the flu and other viruses that we see. But COVID's not going to be gone for some time, and we're going to maintain these precautions for quite some time. And I think the airline industry, it would behoove them to keep this up to maintain safety on travel, both domestically and internationally.
Okay, so that's a good answer. So was there anything positive from this experience? Slowing life down, working remotely, important friends, what, like that type of thing?
So what touched me was the human aspect of healthcare. You know, COVID, at the peak of it, you were alone. And unfortunately, many people that had COVID died alone. And I get all choked up just thinking about this. I think of a lovely, wonderful nurse that would sit there at the bedside with a COVID patient and an iPad and having FaceTime with a family so that they could say their last goodbyes. So I think we learned this human nature is such an important part of caring for each other. And I think it elevated during COVID, you know, dropping off groceries for your neighbor, you know, driving someone to the doctor that wasn't able to drive. I think we learned that part of this is just being good and being nice and being kind. And I think that's, we were all elevated a little bit by COVID that way.
Right. So in the very beginning when we spoke, my big last question was going, you know, could there be another type of pandemic? Because even this one, you know, you watch movies 10 years ago and it's like, oh, this could never happen.
Right.
And then all of a sudden
it
did. So.
So I think we are much better equipped now to handle anything like that happens again. I think the surveillance is going to be on top of it. There are viruses that can morph from animals to humans that we've learned. So the surveillance is there, the technology is there for us to be able to detect it early. We're going to learn from everything that didn't go right with this pandemic. I can't say it won't ever happen again, but we will be much more prepared if there is a next time.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So stay. I'm going to do a switch, and Dr. Killily is going to sit here. Can you speak about vaccines for children under 12?
Well, not yet. The studies are just being initiated now with Pfizer and Moderna to get started with those vaccines. They do safety, they're doing dosing, and they're collecting the data. I know there's a real push to get back to school in September. So I think they're going to try to get the numbers as well as they can to get kids enrolled in these studies If it doesn't happen before September, it will happen sometime during the fall. So hopefully we'll have all that data available so we can get kids vaccinated either before the beginning of fall or during the fall.
Are you worried that if we don't make it by fall that we could see another rise if we don't have younger children vaccinated?
So it seems the younger kids aren't really the problem. Mm-hmm. They're not really transmitting the virus quite as readily mm-hmm. as teenagers who go out and about and do more things and interact in different ways. So if there's an age group that may be not vaccinated yet, I think that might be the age group that would be okay. It's the older kids that we worried about. And that's why they let the young kids go back to school first.
Right.
You know, they remote learning wasn't probably great for them also, but also the transmissibility of the young kids is much less than it is amongst the older kids.
Right.
Another question. How does life look now as we slowly go out to restaurants, parties, friends, you know, movies? The negatives of this experience. People were affected by isolation. And as a result, there was an increase in depression, added anxieties, and then the new word FOGO, fear of going out. You know, we were home, as you said, and then all of a sudden, or with 40 people, it is overwhelming. What would you say to people to get them out and to join the world again?
Well, I would say, and you probably had a similar experience. I was going to work the whole time. I mean, we did do telehealth, which was a great resource, but often I was doing telehealth from my office at work. So it's a little bit, you know, I don't think I have a fear of going out, but I am very mindful of those that do. I have a stack of masks in every bag I own, and everywhere. I just have them always at the ready. I'm not sure.
Do you still have patients that won't come into the office?
Yeah,
me too. So, yeah.
And I respect that. I'm very willing to do telehealth with anyone at any time.
There is that fear. I think you should feel good about the vaccine, but I think you should do what you're comfortable with. I don't think that you should venture out into the world until you feel ready, and everybody can be ready at their own pace.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it can be hard for breast cancer patients though, because as good as telehealth is, it doesn't, as a surgeon, you know, as somebody who uses their hands to help people treat their disease and recover, we can't get around that, right? So we can temporize people
right.
with chemotherapy and with endocrine therapy, but it's hard. It's hard. Mm-hmm.
We have a question that came in. How soon will they be able to start administering PARP inhibitors to qualified patients? And will insurance companies accept this, as we know it is cost prohibitive?
It is a very costly drug. I think it's under discussion right now when olaparib is going to be offered to patients. Do we call patients back if they've recently completed chemotherapy? I really think that there's going to have to be some expert consensus and guidelines that are going to be issued. I can't speak about the insurance reimbursement. You know, I do my best to turn a blind eye, really. To those issues. But I think for now, you know, we're all feeling good that we have this data and that, you know, we will shortly be able to start using it.
So is
off trial.
Thank mm-hmm. you. Is there anything we've missed that your patients have been talking about that we haven't covered today?
So one thing we should talk about are boosters. Probably we will need boosters in the fall. I've seen a bunch of different data that says anywhere from 8 to 12 months. We got vaccinated probably in the first ones in December, so we may need ours earlier than the rest of the population that got vaccinated after healthcare workers. So it's not definite, but it seems probable that boosters will be coming in the fall. Interestingly, people that may not need boosters are people that had COVID and then got both vaccines. Mm-hmm. It appears that there is some amazing memory immune cells in your bone marrow. They call them memory B cells, and these people may be protected for life. So stay tuned for that one.
And will the need for a booster vary depending upon which vaccine you got?
They haven't really said yet, but they seem to be thinking that just one booster in the fall so far would be good for everybody.
So it took a little bit to roll out the vaccine, but once it got rolling, you know, they really did. The United States did a beautiful job. And it's like, if you need that vaccine, you're going to get it. Boosters, and then they have to start all over again, getting it to the, you know, the population. Would it be the same type of system? The same, you know, places you went to get the other vaccine? Would they contact you and say you're ready for a booster? I went to Stanford Hospital. So would that be who would be connected to me and reach out to me? How do you think they're going to do that?
Yeah, I think it would be the same place where you got the original vaccine. It was very efficient.
Yeah.
And hospitals did it, community health centers, drugstores. Mm-hmm. They did a fantastic job. They didn't give it to doctor's offices. We didn't give the vaccine. I'm sure there were plenty of patients of yours that would have rather have gotten it from you, made them feel safer. But it worked. It was very efficient. It would be the same way, the same place where you got your first vaccine.
And hopefully operationally, we have some experience.
Yeah, now
especially
we know how to
with
do
the
it.
Two doses. You know, I agree. It's just amazing response. Mm-hmm.
So we have another question that came in. What are your thoughts on returning back to work in person?
It depends where you work. Depends on what your work environment is like. I think you asked what is one of the things we learned from this is that a lot of people can work remotely. You've seen the traffic out there. A lot of people don't have to be in an office to work. We do, but there are many industries that don't. And I think, again, the same thing I say about going out in the world, venture slowly, go as you're comfortable. And I think, you know, the work and place environment, I think, you know, people are taking that into consideration. And, you know, so maybe we're going to see staggered work schedules. Maybe a certain group will come these days, a different group will come those days. Like we talked about, maybe not having full capacity in the office and maybe keeping it a lower capacity so we don't have as much, you know, face-to-face contact.
So one last question would be, and this is a little bit July 4th, September, back to school. Is that going to be our big test? July 4th would be the big one. It's like, oh my goodness, this is the holiday. We finally get to go out and see fireworks. So I would think a lot of people are going to get together and then you're back to school.
I mean, yeah, it could have been Memorial Day, but here in the Northeast, it was miserable weather. So
I think it was left out. I think somebody wanted that. By the way.
Yeah. So, July 4th, but I think we're already seeing little parts of it, right? Father's Day is coming up. I think people are going to have bigger celebrations than they did last year. And then July 4th, and then all through the summer going through. But yes, the fall, going back to school, kids going back to college, people doing their jobs and staying indoors and being home more. That's when we're going to see if the numbers go up or not. And, you know, we have all those variables involved. What's going on with the variants? Are more people getting vaccinated? Are we getting the kids vaccinated? So many variables will go into it, but I'm hoping, as we all are, that we have a good shot of doing well when we go back.
Are you
inside.
Seeing less of the variants now, or?
No, we're seeing the variant. We're seeing these variants, the majority of most of the strains that are out there. The Delta variant from India is just picking up here. I think it's about 10 to 15%.
All right. Did you want to say any last comments about your patients or anything that we've missed today?
I just really want to reinforce the importance of getting vaccinated. I don't think we really can stress that enough, and the safety and the importance of screening mammography for patients who have been putting it off, because we really are keeping all of those precautions in place, like we mentioned before. Can't stress that enough. We don't want to miss cancers due to delayed screening.
It's safe to go back in your healthcare environment. Please get vaccinated, if not for yourself, for your family, for your loved ones, for your coworkers, for the people around you, so that you can protect them.
So Asante and myself want to thank the doctors. You're brilliant. I think this was so important. And you answered all the questions that I think we're all a little nervous about. And as I used the word before, comfort. You're so helpful.
Thank you for hosting us. It was a pleasure.
Thank you
for listening. And if you have any questions after the fact, I know the doctors would, you know, get back to us and we can email you. So thank you for joining us today. Bye.